The sales tax penny for kids is, yes, certainly, naturally, no question. But I guess we've got 3 minutes to talk about it, so rather than stop with a definite yes, I'll tell you.
One thing I did forget to say, Doug, was that if any of the candidates don't want to take their full 3 minutes, you don't have to. You may. But
make sure you deduct his 34 seconds.
I got it.
One thing that frustrates me is hearing that we're broke. I'm fed up with Mr. Walker and you saying we're broke. We're not broke. We're just not willing to take money from the right places, like the 1%, and put it in the places we need it, like education. If we're going to fund education and the tech schools, there are students waiting in line to go to tech schools right now, and there are jobs waiting for them when they get out of tech school.
You could sit
but
here, you could do it.
Walker so, cuts that by millions of dollars, and he gives it to corporations in special loopholes. We also, I used to be a teacher, and I know that we have to begin to respect teachers. I mean, those are the men and women who spend more time with our kids than many parents spend with their kids. And we have this attitude, you know, that we don't really respect that. And I would change that as governor. I would speak loudly and clearly about how important teachers are. And then we have to talk about having some tuition assistance for young men and women who want to be teachers and right now have trouble getting into school and paying the tuition they need in order to do that. And one last thing is all of these things we promise and talk about, and I'm careful not to say promise. If I do, start waving your hands, because none of us can do that. We have to have a November election where we elect progressive Republicans, and there's a few out there, and Democrats to the Assembly. Because until the Assembly becomes in the control of like-minded people like us and like the Senate will be very soon, we can't pass these things. So I'm going to, as governor of Wisconsin, travel the state working with candidates, talking about these issues and why it's so important to elect men and women to the Assembly who will support education, health care, all the things, women's rights, the issues that we all care so much about. That's going to be critical to turn Wisconsin around next year.
I very much appreciate School Superintendent Beaver's efforts here because I think we share all these values of trying to improve education. And here's my take on how I would go about doing it. And let me start again with what I said once before, which is I think the single biggest fuel for why a recall is happening is because Governor Walker was not honest with his voters. And one of the ways he was not honest was he never told us he would do the biggest cut in public education in our state's history. He then made a series of wrong choices. He did created some big new tax breaks, loopholes for some, and then he had to fund that with this largest cut in public education in our state's history, or attempting to throw 65,000 men, women, and children off their health care. So wrong choices. So me, as governor, will make the single most important investment of state dollars into public education. It is my top priority for spending. And I say this for all the right reasons. Our most valuable resource is our children. The best way to make sure they have successful lives and we grow our economy is to invest in education. Governor Walker's way of big tax breaks for corporations did not produce jobs, and it fails our children. The stories and the people I have seen over the last year are again why I believe that the biggest cuts in public education are the why we will beat Scott Walker in 51 days. I'm in the south side of Milwaukee, and young students there in college say they're not going to be able to get through college day here because of the tuition increases under Governor Walker. I'm up in Ashland, and young people there come to tell me, one young man says, I'm a student at UW-Superior, and I want to be a teacher, but 12 of my friends who also want to be teachers have dropped out of that. I don't see a future in education and teaching, given Governor Walker. As a mom, as a governor, that has to stop. And I saw a senior couple, 75 years old, standing out in the cold in Oshkosh with their clipboard to get signatures signed in the recall. I said, why are you out here? It's freezing cold. They said, because the cuts in education are hurting our children. That is why we will beat Scott Walker in 51 days. I will put together the plans for how I will restore funding for his $36 million cut to the technical college system. Just if you eliminate just one of those tax breaks he created last year, the one that's called the Las Vegas loophole, that cost us $40 million a year. That would fully restore the funding for the technical college system. Not only is that jobs and education for people right now, but we have about over 30,000 job openings in Wisconsin now. Things like welders, pipe fitters, program designers, nurses of every kind. And we have so many people looking for work. And the last thing you want to do as a governor, last thing he should have done as a governor, is cut the technical college system. Way to match people with jobs, that get the training they need, and so that's how we restore the funding of the technical college system. Finally, my principles on education. Whoops.
Kathleen, I realize that we've gotten 3 o'clock, but if we could just impose upon you to stay for a couple more minutes so we get to the labor question, which has been probably the most contentious.
Should we do that one next time?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Because I think it's been the most contentious issue or most discussed issue between the candidates. First of all, and luckily you have the questions in front of you so you can read this. But the question is, this is falling. Should all public employees have the right to form a union and bargain wages, benefits, and working conditions with their employer? And if you favor the restoration of collective bargaining rights for public employees, how would you actually accomplish that, especially if Republicans retain a majority of the assembly after the November elections? Second part of this question is that throughout the uprising last year, many have urged a common understanding that collective bargaining rights for all workers are not just workers' rights, but they are indeed human rights. Do you agree with this, and what is your understanding of this broader view of the right to collectively bargain? How will collective bargaining rights or workers' rights fit into your campaign in the general recall election, especially since the issue of workers' rights was hardly mentioned in the Senate recall campaigns last summer? And finally, how will you present and argue this issue to the general public, a majority of whom are not union members? And if it, with the indulgence of the other candidates, with Kathleen's schedule, could we ask her to go first and then go to the other candidates? And then we'll go back to our, no, okay. In that case, Secretary LaPalla?
Pardon?
You were saying that you would not agree to that?
Well, no, it's
fine.
We were just taking turns going first.
I know we were, and that's why I'm saying, I'm asking for the indulgence of the candidates that we break that order, given Kathleen's schedule. Okay.
If that's a problem, I can wait until you go. You sure?
Just so you know you had to leave.
Yes, the forum people knew I had to leave because I had made a commitment for 4 o'clock, but way before getting this wonderful invitation. But also, if anybody wants to join us at 5:45 after you leave here, I have a video conference on the war on women. Please check out my website and join us on a teleconference. So here's my response to this really important question. And in my intro, now half an hour ago or so, I told you about my roots of growing up as a granddaughter of a bus driver, learning how important it was for collective bargaining and our rights to organize and how it's built the middle class in our country and how important it is for us to make sure the next generation has those same rights. I was also a member of my own union, AFT Local 3628, for 14 years. I knew how important those benefits were for me raising my son as a divorced single mom. But then I was county executive, you know, for 14 years, on the other side of the table, working with 8 unions every day. It was hard. I was really proud of the work we did together. When the market crashed, and it would have been really easy to do as others have done, we took the harder way, the right way to do it. We sat down at the table and bargained. They did their share to help taxpayers. We got the job done. That's why I'm the best candidate to run against Scott Walker, because I'm the only one running who's worked with unions, saved dollars for taxpayers, and has shown how collective bargaining can be respected and works. I'm the candidate that needs it. How do we get it done? And here too, no disrespect intended to my friends here running as well, it's not sufficient to say that you'll introduce a bill or have a special session, because we all know, and I know they would be the first to agree, that the chances of us not having an assembly Republicans, that they gave us that proposition that we got to assume we're going to have a Republican assembly, is that they're not then going to act on the bill. And nobody has offered a better solution than that to the one I have offered. And that is, you have to restore collective bargaining through the only bill that has to pass the legislature, and that's the state budget bill. And that's why that's the right way to do it. You'll notice Governor Walker eliminated 50 years of worker rights by putting in a budget repair bill. And then finally, at that point, we will have a Democratic Senate. We are likely, as David said, to still have Assembly Republicans. But what we need then is leadership. That's what a governor does. And that's why I've said early and often to anyone who's asked me, here's how you restore collective bargaining. If we're serious about it, you have to put it in the budget bill. And if you aren't serious about vetoing it and it doesn't have it in, then it won't happen. And I'm proud to stand with working men and women. Because even if you're not a member of the union, your life has been improved. You have safer working conditions. You have a fair day's wage for a fair day's work. But because people organize to get that for all the rest of us. Thanks.